Yeah. All right.
I don't know.
I don't know either. Well, let's sing for Rose and
happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Rose. Happy birthday to you.
And many more. All right. Well, we are thankful to God that you're part of our gathering, and all of you, you each have your space. That was one of my devotions this week, which was giftedness is the mark of a Christian. We all matter to this gathering. So, all right, that's enough. Extra little sermons before we begin. So let's go ahead. Ellery has a prelude, and then we'll do our confession and forgiveness. Please rise for our confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who journeys with us these 40 days and sustains us with the gift of grace. Amen. Let us acknowledge before God and one another our need for repentance and God's mercy. Holy God, we confess to you our faults and failings. Too often we neglect and do not trust your holy word. We take for ourselves instead of giving to others. We spoil rather than steward your creation. We cause hurt, though you call us to heal. We choose fear over compassion. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us as we seek to follow in your way of life. Amen. Hear the good news. God so loved the world that God gave the only Son, so that all may receive life. This promise is for you. God embraces you with divine mercy and forgives you in Christ's name and revives you in the Spirit's power. Amen. We're going to sing together, "In the Cross of Christ I Glory." That's number 104 in your green hymnal. We're singing verses 1 through 3. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. All right, for our Kyrie, in this Lenten season, we're singing a song that we introduced, or a prayer we introduced at Ash Wednesday. We repeat as congregation, Kyrie eleison, Christe eleison, Kyrie eleison, which is Christ have mercy. Wait, Lord have mercy. Christ have mercy. Lord have mercy. And those are very much our Lenten themes. Now, we're going to, if you're a congregational member, you just keep singing those lines. The rest of us have added in or learned some other things. And you'll hear the violin at a certain point. You'll hear me also put out some prayer petitions for us during this time. So we'll go ahead and small intro from the organist, okay? Kyrie eleison, Christe eleison, Kyrie. Eleison, eleison, Kyrie.
wondrous love that seeks and finds me. Word that raises and unbinds me. When my sin enslaves and blinds me, I call upon you, God. Sun of justice shining o'er me, wind of new life rushing round me, life of every twig and blossom, I call upon you, God. Rock of ages, still support me. Bread of new life, still sustain me. Wine of mercy, tell anew me. I call upon you, God. Christe eleison, Kyrie eleison, eleison, eleison. Kyrie eleison, Christe eleison, Kyrie eleison, eleison.
Let us continue in prayer. O God, our leader and guide, in the waters of baptism, you bring us to new birth to live as your children. Strengthen our faith in your promises, that by your Spirit we may lift up your life to all the world through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. We'll continue. We'll hear from the book of Genesis.
The first reading today comes from Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 through 4a. The Lord said to Abram, "Go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you, I will curse you. And in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed." So Abram went as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him.
Our psalm is Psalm 121. We're going to read it responsively. It's on page 279 in the front of your green hymnal. I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where is my help to come? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. And he who watches over you will not fall asleep. Behold, he who keeps watch over Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord himself watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand, so that the sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve you from all evil. It is he who shall keep you safe. The Lord shall watch over your going out and your coming in from this time forth forevermore.
The second reading today is from the book of Romans, chapter 4, verses 1 through 5, and then verses 13 through 17. What are we to say was gained by Abraham, our ancestor, according to the flesh? For if Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. For what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now, to one who works, wages are not reckoned as a gift, but as something due. But to one who without works trusts him, who justifies the ungodly, such faith is reckoned as righteousness. For the promise that he would inherit the world did not come to Abraham or to his descendants through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. If it is the adherents of the law who are to be the heirs, faith is null and the promise is void. For the law brings wrath, but where there is no law, neither is there violation. For this reason, it depends on faith in order that the promise may rest on the grace and be guaranteed to all his descendants, not only to the adherents of the law, but also to those who share the faith of Abraham. For he is the father of all of us, as it is written, I have made you the father of many nations. In the presence of the God in whom he believed, who gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist. This is the second reading. Please stand for the proclamation of the gospel.
Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. The Holy Gospel according to John, the third chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Now, there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews. He came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God. And Jesus answered him, very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above. And Nicodemus said to him, how can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born? And Jesus answered, very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. And Nicodemus said to him, how can these things be? And Jesus answered him, are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. I'm going to invite our kids to come up. I need to gather some of the things I need. Whoa. Ha ha. Oh my gosh, Wesley is coming. Is that your brother? Okay. I have things for you, things for me. And my first question is anybody really good at math?
Yes.
Yes? Oh, good. Well, this should go well. Okay. So, do we know about the number 7? We're familiar with that. Okay, let's see if we have 7 of us. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. We have 10. But we're going to start out with the number 7. Okay. Now, one of the things we've been learning about in our devotions is about how Jesus died for us and forgave us whenever we were people who chose to not follow God's ways or to sin. Okay? But Jesus said, that's okay, you can start again. Let's start again, I forgive you. All right, so we had that in devotions. But then one of Jesus' followers asked, well, how many times should I forgive someone? Okay, and so Jesus used that number 7 again and said, I want you to forgive 70 times 7. Okay? That's how much? Yeah. We got tens, 7 tens times 7. What do you think, Jermaine? So what if we took these 7 people and we had 7 more of them and 7 more of them, 7 more of them and 7 more of them, 70 times. What do you guys think? Okay, so we're adding them. So what do we want to do to multiply them? What's our 7 times 7? It's one of those doubles. 490, yes. 490. So when he said, well, how many times should I forgive someone? Jesus said 70 times 7. So 490 times. So do you think that that was Jesus saying, okay, you can forgive people and keep count of it, and then once you hit 490, then you're done for the rest of your life? Or do you think he meant you should just keep on forgiving people? So not once a day, not 70 times 7, just however many times I forgave you. And how many times does Jesus forgive us? Like when you're 89, will Jesus still forgive you? Yeah, so I think we will have hit that number by then. So Jesus keeps on forgiving again and again, and he says to us, forgive again and again and again. And that's all because our other number we're going to remember is that when Jesus died on a Friday, how many days later until Jesus rose again? 3 days, right? And that means that what Jesus did for us, God looked at that and said, hey, wow, Jesus is going to be raised again. So it isn't like Jesus gave up after the cross or that his life ended. All right? So 70 times 7. So if you were reading your devotions this week, you heard about a lot of ways to forgive. And I am going to, okay. So we talked about how Jesus is the light and helps us forgive. And I'm going to have, as I say these, I need volunteers to put them on our mobile. We also heard how we could make a chain and how Jesus breaks the chains of our sin. So how about you put that one up? And then we also heard this week, and I'm just reviewing, hug one of your stuffed animals before you go to bed and thank Jesus for being your shepherd. Any of you get, you guys, yeah, you remember that one? Okay. And then wear a blindfold and try to empty the trash. Did anybody try that one? And then thank God for all the things we had. I'm going to let you put that one up. So adults, you should try these things. Think of a friend who needs to know Jesus' love and invite them to church. That was another idea. I'm going to let you hang that on our mobile. And how can even little people be a big helper? And that was because it was the little boy who brought the lunch. So, and then ask God to bless our time together is the last one here. So let's do that as our final blessing. Okay. Dear Jesus, bless this group who has gathered. Bless this group who has gathered. Amen. Amen. I don't think that grammar was correct, so that's your challenge. You get to correct it and bring back the correct phrase for me or one of you teachers out there. I'm putting these up. It's a picture of all our faces. Okay. All right, let's head on back to where we were seated or where we were staying for the service. And I'm starting to think that Harper just wants to stay up here. I'm starting to wonder. Be prepared. Kids that want to stay up front sometimes stay up front and do other things like, I'm going to be the pastor, I'm going to be the organist, I'm going to be something from up there. All right. Oh, I forgot to give them their puzzle sheets. So, okay. Let's pray together. Dear Lord Jesus, I thank you that you call us together. Today, we hear from Nicodemus, and we hear how John, the gospel writer, tells his story and shares the teachings of Jesus. I ask that you would give us a fuller understanding of you and your presence in our lives as we go through this Lent. We hear these lessons. As we come to know you through these lessons, we realize how much you already know us, and how much you treasure us, and how much you are ready and waiting to be a presence in our lives. I ask that you continue to walk with us in our Lenten journey, and it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Now, I know some of you follow your details as to what's going on here at church via Facebook. I know some of you do. And I always give you your Saturday notice. And did any of you watch the video that went with our Saturday notice? Anybody catch it? It's a pretty popular one on the internet. You should go back and look for it and watch it. It's of a duck that's walking along with all her ducklings. And they're all in a nice, neat row behind her as she's walking along. And then in the video, along comes a gust of wind, and they all just flatten to the ground, the little ducklings. And they just look like little puffs that have fallen and are flat on the ground. It's just so cute. And then the wind gives up and they pop back up. And then the wind comes along and they fall over and then they pop back up. And then over time, the wind gets even stronger and then mama goes down too. It's just one of those really cute things. If you can see the wind through the movements of the duck and the ducklings, and at one point it gets really hard and just slides the little ducklings across. So it's just a fun thing to see. And I've always been struck by that video because it just really shows how wind can go to work in our lives. And we've witnessed that a lot this week, having to deal with spring storms and high winds. And they can do a lot of things. Winds can. It can move, it can empower, it can ebb, it can flow, it can create, it can destroy, it can move us sideways, it can cause us to tumble upside down, it can be gentle, but suddenly it can be fierce. Suddenly it can be fierce. Today we receive a rich passage from the Gospel of John about Jesus meeting with Nicodemus. And I promise that during Lent, we'd always be lifting up Jesus' identity and how it was revealed in each of these unique gospel lessons. Now, today, I want to narrow the focus of this very rich passage to Jesus' remarks in verse 3, where he's been talking about the reign of God and how it comes from being born from above. And Nicodemus questions Jesus in response to that really strange remark. Now, we're used to hearing things like that, but just think how strange that would be to hear. In order for you to take on who God is, you'll have to be born from above. So Nicodemus answers, how can anyone have that happen to them? After especially we've grown old, can anyone enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born? Jesus, what are you talking about? And Jesus says, certainly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born. And then he speaks about it again, being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished. Why would you not know what it means to be born from above? And Jesus continues in our English translation to talk about the wind. We heard that the wind blows where it will. We don't know where it's coming from. We don't know where it's going. But if you were reading this whole passage in Greek, you wouldn't see that switch from spirit to wind. It'd be all one word. It would be that word pneuma. And so we might hear it this way. The spirit blows where it chooses. And you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who was born of the spirit. So it kind of, instead of thinking, oh, it's just a comment about the wind, it's a comment about the Spirit of God. So if the Spirit is like the wind, you have to think about, does the Spirit blow? Does it move? Does it empower? Does it ebb and flow? Does it create and destroy? Does the Spirit move us sideways and sometimes upside down? Is it gentle, but then is it sometimes fierce? So Jesus pulls that metaphor out, and it makes us wonder about the Spirit. So what about this Spirit, and what is it, and who is it? And John, the gospel writer, builds a case throughout his gospel that Jesus, this man, this teacher sitting down with Nicodemus, the one who we know as our friend and as our Savior. As last week we talked about how Jesus is the royal Son of God, this one is also, and importantly so, the embodiment of the Holy Spirit. And in Scripture, the Spirit is the very creative power of God who moved over the waters at the time of creation as the wind, who spoke creation into existence with that mighty voice, "Let there be light, let there be darkness," who that is the same Spirit. The same Spirit then as we heard about in that Ash Wednesday time, who breathed life into the dust of who we are. That's who Jesus is. Jesus is that power and Spirit. So do you remember the opening words of this Gospel of John that we read near Christmas time? And if you want to have Gospel of John out today, that might be helpful. But in chapter 1, he started his gospel this way and said, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God, and all things came into being through him. And without him, not one thing came into being." So John says, this is who I'm talking about. This Jesus was this Word at the beginning of time. So that's where John starts to first make that case. And later on, when John comes on the scene, John testifies that Jesus is the one on whom the Spirit descends. So if we look at verse 32 of chapter 1, he says, "I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it remained on him. I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water said to me, 'He on whom you see the Spirit descend and remain is the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit.'" So that gets set up when Jesus appears on the scene. And then later on in chapter 3, verse 34, we hear of this teaching one, "He whom God has sent speaks the words of God, for he gives the Spirit without measure." So Jesus is being described as the one who was the Spirit, gives the Spirit, receives the Spirit. It's on Jesus that the Spirit remains. Now the gospel at this point heads off into these stories that we're going to continue to get during Lent. And then when we get to the very end of John and Jesus saying his goodbye words, it comes up again. And in John 14, 17, we hear Jesus saying this. Let me make sure I'm getting to the right page. "This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, because he abides with you, and he will be in you." And Jesus says, "You know the Spirit. I'm here with you. You've come to know who the Spirit is." And then Jesus, even in John 14, 26, says, "But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I said to you." So just constantly, Jesus and the Spirit are on the same wavelength. And then in chapter 15, verse 26, "When the Advocate comes, who I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who comes from the Father, he will testify on my behalf." So just constantly we have those connections happening. Now, as we continue to go through that farewell discourse, and Jesus is on the cross and he is dying, Jesus at the very end, when he had received the wine, said, "It is finished." And then he bows his head and gave up his spirit. Gave up his spirit. The other gospels don't say it that way, but it is Jesus at that point. So there's this, the spirit is on Jesus. The spirit is being passed on by Jesus. And then at the very end of John, Jesus is with those disciples after he has risen from the dead. And he says, he breathes on them, says to them, breathes on them, just like that creator God at the beginning of the world, breathing into the dust, breathes on them and says to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit." So John makes sure we're not missing this picture that Jesus is, when he is among those disciples and embodied, there's the Spirit. But then it doesn't go away. When Jesus ascends, Jesus has given it now to this body. It's not always, I have skipped a page on this and put it back over here. I think it's okay. Okay, I got to stop and think because I'm missing a whole page. So I just have to stop and think. All right. So I wanted you to see Jesus' identity then as the one who carries the Spirit and gives the Spirit to all of us. But when we think about that image of wind and what blows and what sends things upside down and tumbling, and like those little ducklings gets blown across the flat surface, it can be like not always a comforting thought. It's nice to know that Jesus is good shepherd and that Jesus is friend and that Jesus forgives our sin. But when we think about the fact that Jesus embodies the powerful wind of creation, we're not sure sometimes we want to get in on that God-breathed adventure. Now, William Temple once wrote, in response to that thought, "Don't wait till you know the source of the wind before you let it refresh you, or its destination before you spread sail to it. It does offer you what you need. Trust yourself to it." He encourages us to fuss with this. What does this mean if Jesus is the blowing wind, the upsetting wind, the tumbling wind, the wind that causes things to tumble? Well, I started to think about how wind is technically the flow of gases, okay? It's just on this large scale. It's going across the surface of the earth, and there's this bulk movement of air, and it's always moving from areas of higher air pressure to lower air pressure. And in the end, what does that pressure mean? It just means more molecules are moving around in that area of high pressure, and that those molecules want to move where they've got more room in that area of low pressure. So that's constantly where that flow is going. And so I thought to myself, where in our lives, where in my life are there sparse places? Are there thin places where there's all this room and it's deserted and it's almost empty? I think some people allow themselves to be in those kind of spaces when they fast, when they're being quiet in prayer. Some people get that forced upon them with grief or loneliness or betrayal, or when just something about their life is stripped away, all of a sudden they're in a space like that. And Jesus today portrays himself as a refreshing wind, as the changing wind, as the destructive wind, as the wind that rushes into the empty space and filling it up again with what? You know, Jesus says, with what? We don't know. but trusting that whenever there's that kind of movement, new creation is happening. It's being made in us and through us. It's like the moment of creation when the breath is being blown into our lungs. So the gospel writer John, as we went with our kind of mini Bible study here, says you need to understand Jesus as the vessel of the Holy Spirit, as the one who opens himself fully to the creative power that God asks to offer. And he allows himself to experience that really destructive wind of death on the cross. He sees that giving up and that becoming empty as the catalyst to the fullness of everything that could be given, the fullness of the resurrection life. And on the cross, we heard Jesus gives up his spirit for us. He gives away the wind in his sails, the wind that is there. We also heard then that the resurrected Jesus gathers us together and says, here I am. I'm going to breathe into you once again, the living spirit. The living spirit is now yours. So let's pray together. Dearest Jesus, help us to be enveloped by this vision of who Jesus is given to us by that Gospel of John, Jesus as living spirit, as that creative spirit present at the day of creation. I ask that you would open us over and over to the fact your spirit is seeking to be in us. Help us to open our eyes to the way that it is moving and the way you want us to be changed, or the way you want us to leave a piece behind and pick up a new piece in this time of repentance and turning. Help us to receive your spirit. I know, Lord Jesus, that that will happen in so many different ways in this gathering of peoples. It will happen in so many different ways across the globe in churches and in our neighboring churches. Your spirit is at work. Help us to listen for and watch for and sense the wind of your spirit. It's in your name we pray. Amen. One of the places we powerfully define the work of the Spirit is in the day of baptism and in the dying and rising with Christ in those baptismal waters. So some of our hymns are helping us make that link today. We're going to sing together, "We Were Baptized in Christ Jesus." It's number 698 in your blue hymnal. We were baptized in Christ Jesus. We were baptized in his death. We were, Christ was raised victorious. We might live a brand new life. And if we have been united in a dreadful death like his, we will all be reunited, for he lives. In the water, in the witness, in the breaking of the bread,
in the waiting arms of Jesus, who is risen from the dead. God has made a new beginning from the ashes of our past. In the losing and the winning, we hold fast. God the Father, glory be to Christ the Son. The Holy Spirit, ever three and ever one, as it was in the beginning, glory now resounds again, in a song that has no ending. Amen.
I'm going to invite you to stand, and we're going to confess together the words of our faith with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. It was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He ascended into heaven. And the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We are sustained by God's abundant mercy, and so we pray for the church, the world, and all of creation. O God, you so love your church. Raise up leaders who care for your people. Bless lay theologians, seminary and college professors, and all who are called to the ministry of teaching, especially those who teach among us, that they form and inspire us for the work of the gospel. Merciful God, receive our prayer. O God, you so love your creation. Breathe new life into our planetary home. Guide the work of researchers, scientists, and agriculturalists who love your earth and who inspire us to care for the natural world. Merciful God, receive our prayer. O God, you so love the world. Uphold leaders who resist tyranny and oppression. Strengthen organizations that promote peace and harmony. Direct their work to alleviate human suffering and to address its root causes. Merciful God, receive our prayer. O God, you so love your people. Draw near to all who live with mental illness, depression, or addiction, and accompany them in healing and recovery. Hear the cries of those who look to you in their distress. We especially today want to remember and pray for Pat Pontius. We also ask that you be with the family of Art Dossman. We thank you for the progress that Mike Spriggs has made, and we ask that you continue to bring him healing. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Oh God, you so love your children and those blessed with countless years. Bless the young in our midst and delight us with their joy, wonder, and curiosity. Bless the elderly in our midst and delight us with their wisdom and patience. Revive all our ministries with children and youth and also our aging adults, and equip us all for faithful discipleship. Especially ask that you work in Kara and Doug's family as part of their work of discipleship begins, especially in baby Donna. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Oh God, you so love your saints. As our ancestors in the faith have been a blessing to us, so inspire us by their example of holy living to be a blessing to those who come after us. Merciful God, receive our prayer. We lift our prayers to you, O God, trusting in your steadfast love and your promise to renew your whole creation through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. May the peace of Christ be with you all. Share that peace with those around you as you are able. God's peace be with you. I will wrap them up and intro the offering here. We'll continue with our offering. That's all right, Lily. Okay. You let her come here. Okay, why don't you take this from me? There you go. We have a new hymn for our offertory. For some, it will be old. It's number 713 in our blue hymnal, Lord, Let My Heart Be Good Soil. So as we offer our offerings, we offer our hearts. So please stand for that. It's number 713 in your blue hymnal. Let my heart be good soil, open to the seed of your word. Lord, let my heart be good soil, so love can grow and peace is understood. Where my heart is hard, break the stone away. Where my heart is cold, warm it with the day. When my heart is lost, lead me on your way. Lord, let my heart, Lord, let my heart be good soil. Let us pray. God of good gifts, receive these and all our offerings as we present them in faithful service for the sake of your gospel. Prepare our hearts to receive you in this meal as you pour out your very presence through Christ Jesus, the wellspring of eternal life. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. You call your people to cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast that, renewed in the gift of baptism and by your Spirit, we may come to the fullness of your grace. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. It's shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. This is the body of Christ, the blood of Christ given for you. All are welcome at the table. You may be seated. If you want to commune, we'll commune you now. If you want to. Should have told them. We're good. We're good. I should have told you. The body of Christ given for you. The body of Christ given for you. The body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. Go in peace.